So, good morning, colleagues, peers, friends. On behalf of the Academic Senate, it is the prop. Brian, thank you. Talking about old age, or whatever. So, on behalf of the Academic Senate, it is my pleasure to introduce this year's distinguished faculty chair. And having so many new people, forgive me as an historian, a little background here, okay? So this is the highest privilege award that a faculty member can get from their peers. What happens is that, let me read the criteria. It's a recognition of a career of excellence over time in all of the following areas. So instruction, campus service, professional development, and civic involvement. That is the quote from the Senate's document, its call for proposals. Faculty are nominated by their peers and then are considered by a committee of mostly past award winners. This committee is incredibly jealous of its privilege and every year struggles to find the most distinguished faculty member for it. And then having been put through the committee, the award of this faculty member, and you might want to hear this too because there's no money at all, it's called a chair, but no money comes with it whatsoever. You get a chair. Okay. And you get the incredible onerous responsibility of ruining your summer to put together an address for all your colleagues on this campus of their choice. So you have the whole year, the whole summer to worry about this. So for those of you who have put forward someone and nominated, just thank you so much. It takes time. And if you're thinking right now, oh my gosh, we really should do so-and-so. We really should put forward so-and-so, yeah? How many of you are sort of thinking that now? Oh God, I meant to do this. Would you just hold that thought and do it, and that little extra work? So thank you very much. Because the reason why we do this is obviously not just for this one example of excellence, but it's to acknowledge the excellence in all of us faculty, and may I add, staff as well, in our institution. That's what this is about. We're acknowledging our commitment to excellence. So thank you for those who've done that. Right, this year, are we there? And it's one of those very few secrets left on campus, okay, you know, I think. So this year, this is the 17th person to win this award. It's not one of our first annuals. This is a really old Moorpark tradition, okay? This person came to Moorpark College in 1993. They worked at CSU Los Angeles before us and then went on to Rancho Santa Ana College. Looking at excellence in instruction, one of those four categories, this person specializes in the STEM field. They taught in a learning community, though, by the way, with philosophy. So you're thinking, okay. They really focused their work on students who are underrepresented and have more struggles, perhaps need more attention from us. Their final word, I think, a student, okay, from the many letters that we had. I was unsure about my future and where I should go, and they made me believe that I can make it, okay? Campus service, excellence. College advisory boards, CTC, environmental science, engineering. One of the things that really impressed me on this was they designed a web page that is used by so many students on our campus and by many of this person's peers across, by the way, I should say not just Moorpark, but across the state. They're now setting up an online training course that would allow other people to train to do this discipline more a bit anon. Multicultural Day, of course. Excellence in professional development. This person embodies the lifelong learner. Unbelievable. Science education, foreign languages, including Middle Kingdom Egyptian hieroglyphics. Just completed, I believe, a three-year course on somatic psychology and PTSD therapy. Yeah, and really specialized a lot in international service learning and study abroad. Are we all there yet? But exceptional civic involvement. Not just excellent, I mean, just exceptional. Apart from that international service learning, they embody doing that. This person has worked in Egypt, Peru, Mexico, has presented both nationally and internationally. As an historian, the Black Madonnas of Europe, the diffusion of African ISIS, something I know a little about, and this person has presented on this. They have advised banks in Mexico on this person's specific skills, Indian women in Mexico in their own business skills. They've been a receptionist for a human rights organization, and they have washed the feet of the elderly and painted their toenails. That to me was the final amazing detail. So, are we all there, ladies? Oh, if you're not there, this blanket belongs to this person. Are you there? For those of you who knew this person. So, it is my pleasure to introduce the 2016-17 Distinguished Faculty Chair recipient, Professor Danita Redd.
Okay, so you'll find supplemental information about this presentation on my website. I'll push it, the button, so it'll go live this evening. I have a blog there. You'll find an outline of this presentation, bibliography, and supplemental video. When I learned I was to speak to you today, I selected a topic that I wanted to share with you, not only with you, but with two of my nephews. One in particular has a very strong interest in this topic. It's a topic that I spent 3 years studying in a formal program. I studied it in Santa Monica and in New York. And I still continue to engage with my colleagues and classmates of the program. My topic is one my father mentioned to me when I was in my 20s. He talked to me about it. I'm not sure if I really got it, but I understood a little bit of what he was trying to tell me, but I really didn't get it until I was in my 40s. And that was a long time ago. And it's an issue that my colleagues in counseling, we have to deal with frequently. It comes up all the time. I tell my students that when it comes to problems, and not only my students, but my colleagues, when it comes to big problems, there isn't one person who has the answer. We all have little pieces. And I often say this problem is like a jigsaw puzzle. We all have little pieces to help solve the problem. My topic PTSD, somatic experiencing, also known as SE, students, society, revenge, veterans, tribes, and hope. According to the Mayo Clinic, PTSD cuts across socioeconomic groups, countries, ages, and cultures. I'm going to share with you a few statistics and basic facts from the VA, NIH, and CDRN Institute. There are unwanted memories. Veterans. Mental health patients. Staggering cost. More women than men, more children than adults. PTSD feels like chronic stress, chronic grief, chronic sadness, chronic discomfort, chronic pain, chronic fear. Death is not the greatest loss in life. The greatest loss is what dies inside us while we live. So I mentioned I was in a formal program. That program is known as the Foundation for Human Enrichment. We call it the FHE. The program grants continuing education units to medical doctors, therapists, and other medical and mental health workers. Quick review, there's a threat. We have fight, flight, freeze, or fold. By the way, I'm going to give you a real simple explanation. It doesn't by any means cover all the biology that's involved with trauma and PTSD, but it's a little taste of it for you. Danger, Will Robinson, danger. Those of you who remember Lost in Space, the TV show, movie, well, the amygdala of our brain is sort of like that robot in Lost in Space. It says to us, danger, danger. When the threat is gone, it says all clear. Now, a good way to help us understand what's happening with our sympathetic nervous system, I'm going to use a Hoberman spear. And my explanation may kind of feel like you're back in grammar school, but it's just a good way to illustrate it and kind of give people a sense of what's happening. So if we think of our nervous system normal, it's going to be right about here. And threats come, and it decides it's going to run or fight, or it's going to withdraw, freeze, fold, but it always manages to get back to this place. What causes PTSD is that our emotional response overrides our natural process. So a person with PTSD doesn't go back to this point. They're out here, hypervigilant, are withdrawn. They're not experiencing what it means fully to live in and enjoy a body. PTSD happens because one stress cycle becomes dysregulated and stuck. Now, one of the things that, in addition to my father mentioning it to me, before I came here, I worked at Santa Ana College. And I had a cohort of students, a small cohort. Half of them were from Cambodia and Vietnam. They weren't doing well in school. And when I would speak to them, they would tell me about headaches, stomach aches, not being able to sleep at night. And then I asked, as time went on, I felt more comfortable in knowing the students. I asked them more. And they told me things about seeing people they know killed, having guns held to their head, and living their life constantly on edge until they managed to make it here. But it was obvious they were still living in the past. Why we should care about PTSD? The influence of PTSD impacts all of us, every single one of us. By the way, my colleagues at the FHE have recommended to me the work of Dr. Peggy Mitchell Clark. Her work focuses on PTSD, mostly in college students, but also in K through 12. And I have information from her posted to my blog. Here are some examples from somatic experiencing and how PTSD impacts us. Here's some more. The last one there really got me. Chronic desire for revenge. Here's some causes of PTSD in the SE model. You know, the evening news doesn't give us a break from hearing about trauma in the world. There are unwanted memories. And I use the word intrusive because the past intrudes on the present. Some intrusive illnesses. Alvin Toffler died earlier this year. He wrote, "Our moral responsibility is not to stop the future, but to shape it, to channel our destiny in humane directions, and to ease the trauma of transition." There are traditions that speak of generational trauma. The process for how trauma and PTSD is passed on can now be understood through biology. The image I'm showing you here is from March of this year, and Cell, it's a biology journal, has published some writings about it, and I have a good list of resources so that you can read more about it on my blog. Consider collective trauma, such as with African Americans, Native Americans, survivors of Holocaust. One of my faculty members, one of our professors, is an expert on collective trauma, and I want you to be aware of her work. Also, you'll find information about her posted to my website. Now, PTSD and trauma have a lot of to do with what we see in the headlines today. Here are some recent points from recent headlines. PTSD causes irrational fears. The line dividing good and evil cuts through the heart of every human being. Why do humans kill, maim, and torture one another? My question is, why do humans seek revenge? They destroy each other's homes, hopes, and dreams. By doing so, they kill their own futures. So Sebastian Younger, the journalist, has spent almost his whole career working with the military and with vets. And on his interviews in his book, Tribe, he found that military on active duty, not those who've been discharged, were least likely to suffer from PTSD. And what he realized, it was that the friendships, the togetherness, the unit, is what served as a buffer from PTSD. Alone, we can do so little. Together, we can do so much. So not only somatic experiencing is just one model, one way. Another way that can help someone recover from trauma so that they don't develop PTSD is to provide them with a lot of touch. And actually, the Foundation for Human Enrichment has noted that a person who's been traumatized, if they're quickly brought into a circle of people who love them, who they trust, they get a lot of hugs, a lot of rubs, and they're told everything's going to be okay, and even given a chance to reenact what happened, maybe with a happier, more successful outcome, they don't develop PTSD. And so, what they're saying agrees with what Sebastian Younger has found, is that people, when they're working together and being together, have a buffer that can protect them from developing PTSD. This is our vet center and our vet representative in the center, who's one of our distinguished staff members here at Moorpark College. Staff Sergeant Robert Felix, he's retired. When I read the writings of Sebastian Younger, I was reminded too of our communities on our campus. We don't need to wonder if our student or any particular student has PTSD. We know that communities help students. We have a new community I was happy to see. It's called a Passport to Learning Resources, that's from the math department. We have the STEM learning community on the second floor of the physical sciences building. There's honors, there's rad tech, there's nursing, there's performing arts, there's EDM, there's robotics. We can't have enough communities for our students. And every single one of us is a facilitator for those communities. We're here to sell hopes and dreams and possibilities to our students. And every single one of us has a role in making that happen and creating this community that is a safe place for students. Signs, symbols, and public mourning are very important to the military. When a soldier or a military personnel has fallen, as soon as they can, they will mourn the person publicly. They help them with their healing so that they can move on. Operation Bushmaster is a simulation. It's not real. It's a field exercise done every year. Half the participants are medical professionals in the military. Even though they know it's a simulation, every year they note that the military personnel participating struggle deeply with the idea of losing a member of their unit. Whether they are wounded or die, they become dramatically, greatly impacted, such as the image here from one of their more recent musters. The image for the fallen soldier memorial service you saw, that was for my nephew from this year in April. I mentioned when I found that I've learned that I was going to speak to you, I picked the topic of PTSD for him. Not because of his military service, actually. My nephew has an interest, or had an interest, in collective trauma. And my sister said he used to walk around all the time saying, the problem with teenagers is PTSD. The problem with teenagers is PTSD. He was a sergeant, he was a pretty tough guy. He was the strongest person I had ever met in my life, even from when he was a toddler. I've never seen anyone as physically strong as he was. Well, I told you the military believes in public mourning. So 3 weeks after he passed away, they asked us to join them. They actually asked us a couple of days after he passed, but we went 3 weeks later. None of us wanted to go except for my sister, and she made us go. She said we had to go. She's a vet herself, and she understood why we had to do if we did. So 3 weeks, we had to start giving back to the community. I recently received this text message from my sister. The bottom line there is something that our father taught us, is that we give to others, you do for others. And people, I tell my students this all the time, when they tell me about the hardships and their bad luck, I tell them the best thing you can do is take that and turn it, take something horrible and sour and make it something sweet by giving back. And I encourage my students to not only volunteer locally, I actually try to get them to be global volunteers, and I have many students who are interested in it. Dr. Napistek, who I mentioned, or whose slide you saw at the beginning, says there's a gift in trauma. There's a gift in PTSD. Sometimes it feels hard to imagine it. Someone I loved once gave me a box full of darkness. It took me years to understand that this too was a gift. So my brothers, to help with their grieving, and remember now, somatic experiencing lists bereavement as a cause of PTSD. Both of my brothers are now volunteering for the USO, United Service Organization. This brother owns a gym, and he's donating some of his earnings to the USO. My little brother, once a Marine, always a Marine, has already had a fundraiser for the USO in the name of our nephew. So we're kind of taking our leadership from our dad. He says, you know, you gotta give back, and he was that way himself. By the way, here's my father, my role model. You know, as a kid, I was grumpy because he wasn't around as much as I wanted him to be, but as an adult, I'm proud of the things that he's done, that he did with his life. So, tribe matters. Sebastian Younger says tribe matters. When I was in Peru, I worked with people from the highlands down in Lima. They were from the Andes, but were displaced and were living in Lima. They were caught in the middle of the civil war between the Peruvian government and the communist organization known as the Shining Path. They didn't have any involvement with either group, but they became the victims. They made me study and read all of this literature and make sure I understood who these people were, their history, what happened with the Shining Path. When I was there working with them, I never saw it. They were like little children having the best time of their life. I also work as an ambassador for Shared Hope International. And I always get people to donate to Shared Hope through a very simple way. You can go on to Smile Amazon. Amazon has a site called Smile Amazon. It looks just like their regular site. And if you select Shared Hope as a charity, some of the profits that they've earned from whatever purchases you make will be donated to Shared Hope International. This summer, I went to Minneapolis to visit the People Center. There's three of them in Minneapolis, and they're free medical facilities. The one that I went to serves a refugee population of Somali Muslims. My tour guides were two medical doctors. One had been a medical doctor there since the 70s, and then that woman up on the left there, or on your right, was one of the other tour guides. They told us that they were driven by mission and not by salary. The one who had been there since the 1970s raised a son who became a medical doctor, and he joined the staff. I also went to Spain this summer. I visited hospitals in three different cities. I was taken on tours of these hospitals. Our tour guides were medical doctors. And they spoke to us about the consciousness in Spain of a collective consciousness and how they take care of each other. They consider having free medical care and free education all the way through PhD. I don't know if you want a second one, you can even do that for free in Spain. And they told us too, because they don't earn that much money working as a medical doctor, that they were driven by passion and by mission. When I was walking near the Prado Museum, I saw that banner that said, "Refugees Welcome." I could not believe it. I mean, that was big on a building. You couldn't miss it. Wow. PTSD is an explanation, but it's not an excuse. and it's only a partial explanation. As I said, we're here selling hopes and dreams and possibilities to our students. So when my sister thought about having to go back to work, and she still hasn't returned to work fully, some of the doctors spoke to her, and one of them is a painter. He's a Cambodian-American painter, and she had long admired his work. He gave her the painting that you see there. Now, every year, this doctor and a team of Cambodian-American doctors go back to Cambodia to provide free medical care. Many of the people they serve are missing limbs. Many of them were victims of the Pol Pot regime. Every year they ask my sister to go with them. And she says, not this year, no, maybe. I'll think about it. Well, when they presented her with the painting and spoke to her and reminded her of all the good things she had left to do, one of them, she said the youngest one of the group, asked her again to join them in Cambodia. And he said that they would teach her how to fit people with prosthetics. She told me, she told them yes. Forgiveness does not change the past, but it does enlarge the future. It doesn't take a lot of strength to hang on, it takes a lot of strength to let go. Why you should care about PTSD? In every deliberation, we must consider the impact on the seventh generation, even if it requires having skin as thick as the bark of a pine. And there's hope. Affliction comes to us not to make us sad, but sober. Not to make us sorry, but wise. I conclude with the hope that this work contributes in some small way to our collective understanding of how we can come to peace with our difficult memories and feelings. Here are some people of my tribes. Now, I didn't get images of everybody, but I got some. And these are people who make my life a joy. And I watch them make other people's lives a joy. And with my department, so most people who know me know I have an extremely goofy sense of humor. There's a young man who was 16 years old in 2012, who sketched me one day when I was in one of my grumpy moods. And I can get grumpy. People who know me know that. It's just who I am. My siblings are very slender and athletic. And recently, they've been sending me these text messages of this bear, Paddington Bear. They see a resemblance, they said. Now, something amazing happened to me this morning, and I have to share it with you. I went to check my mail and opened a package, and there was G.I. Joe Star Trek in my mailbox. This was sent to me, some of you remember Patricia Burkhead, who used to be the principal and counselor for the high school at Moorpark College. Her husband sent this to me. He's a Vietnam War vet. And what they didn't know is that I have a Ken Star Trek doll in my office, and I have a Barbie Star Trek doll in my office. A few years ago, Barbie got mad at Ken, and she put a note on herself that says, waiting for G.I. Joe. Here's G.I. Joe. I'm not done. I'm still not done. I'm still not done. I think I need Brian. Wait just a minute. I have a short video and two slides for you.
Here we go. Doing the blind trust experiment, hence the blindfold, and really an indication of you don't care who it is that who approaches you. You can't judge them. You can't see them. And are they willing to accept you, you know, for who you are? And a lot of the people, you know, some people say I'm Swiss, I'm from here, I'm from there. You know, it's just accept people for who they are. And I wanted to do it here, Montgomery, Alabama, the, you know, birthplace of the civil rights movement and the, you know, cradle of the Confederacy, and to prove people that it's not the same old South. Double hug. Oh,
double hug.
Thank you. God bless you guys. Thank you.
Let's go.
Thank you. For one, thank you so much. God bless. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you so much.
Have you had a good day?
I'm having a great day. God bless you. Thank you, man. God bless you. God bless you.
Awesome.
Shut up! I have two more.
So several years ago, I think it was in response to 9/11, the Mexican government started an international fair. Happens every year now in Mexico City. I visited the fair in 2011, and I dream about going back again. It was one of the most amazing experiences of my life. I went every single day. Well, while I was at the fair, I received a gift. Actually, I got two of them. And I wanted to share the gift with you. That says free hugs. Would you please turn to your neighbor? And if you want, stand up and give your neighbor a hug. It needs to be at least 20 seconds. Thank you so very much. I'm done. And let's have a look at the chair. Thank you. Thank you.